Can metformin be used for weight loss in diabetics and non-diabetics alike? We will cover new, groundbreaking research which shows how powerful this medication is at not only lowering blood sugars, but how it aids in both fat loss and muscle gain. As a type 1.5 LADA, or technically a type 1 diabetic, I will explain why I also use this medication to help leverage both my A1C values and for better body composition. Finally, you will get some up-to-date tips and limitations this medication has. What are the best doses and which brands would you want to avoid? But before we begin, let me welcome all of you resilient diabetics out there. This is the channel we turn ordinary, struggling diabetics into extraordinary, well-controlled diabetics. If you don't know who I am and you are brand new to this channel, I welcome you. My name is Jay Sampat, and I am an insulin-dependent diabetic diagnosed a little over 6 years ago. So, the proud owner of a pancreas that's gone on a permanent and a lifelong vacation. So not only am I a diabetic just like you, where we will be walking that walk and talking that talk together, but I do also have a university bachelor of science degree in nutrition dietetics. And that does come in very, very handy in discussing all the intricacies of being a diabetic. The unique information presented today will only be found here on the Resilient Diabetic. New life-changing episodes are released weekly. So if you want to learn more and you want to be notified by YouTube that a new video has been published, then the only way to do that is to first hit that subscribe button, followed by the gray notification bell. Then choose turn on all notifications. And of course, if you liked what you learned today, please hit that like button for me. Metformin is considered a first-line medication in the treatment for type 2 diabetes, and its main action was thought to lower the amounts of glucose released by the liver, especially at night. But there is much, much more to how this medication works. Our main focus today is how it helps insulin work better by helping muscles use glucose more efficiently. In other words, it increases the sensitivity of muscle cells to glucose so that the excessive glucose in the blood can be removed and stored in the muscle instead of being either converted to fat and then stored or continue to flow around in larger and larger amounts, thus destroying the nerves and small blood vessels alike. So this is a twofold mechanism. When insulin works better and insulin sensitivity improves, the amount of insulin needed drops. Thus, one's pancreas does not have to work so hard, or in my case, less insulin is needed to be injected. Why is this important? 1 in 3 are now pre-diabetic, and it will get progressively worse. And for many who have become diabetic, the pancreas has just been worn out or is burnt out due to years of excessive carbohydrate intake. The body has become highly resistant to insulin due to the fats known as triglycerides that have been stored in all the wrong places, such as inside the muscle tissues, within the liver, and in and around the body organs. But as we have discussed, these fats are not coming from the fats we eat, but rather from the excessive carbohydrates that have been consumed, both the good and the bad. It is then our livers that convert these carbs into fats, which then cause insulin resistance. Remember, in type 2 diabetes, years of the pancreas beta cells having to pump out ever increasing higher and higher amounts of insulin because of the resistance then begins its own demise. It just gets tired and worn out. But another important point to factor in, all this occurs over years, sometimes decades, prior to being diagnosed. So by the time of diagnosis, 50% of beta cell functioning may have already been lost for many, many diabetics. In my case, I had what's known as an autoimmune disease that occurred due to a severe gluten allergy attack. My own immune system subsequently destroyed all my pancreatic beta cells, which produce insulin, and did this within a few years, thus making me an insulin-dependent diabetic. New, groundbreaking research has shown it is where the fats are stored that separates the healthy individuals from the unhealthy. If the excessive calories and carbohydrates are being stored subcutaneously, that is directly under the skin as fat, then one can still remain healthy and have high insulin sensitivity. If one has the genes that converts the excessive carbs into fats, then stores them in places that cannot be seen, such as in the liver, inside the muscle cells, and in between the body organs, then you will develop diabetes and all the other host of health issues that follows. This is why the vast majority of new diabetics you now see today, they look normal. They are not obese or extremely overweight, because again, it's the fats you cannot see that is now killing society as a whole. The million-dollar question, could metformin help in either case of fat distribution? Or rephrased, can metformin help you lose weight even if you are not a diabetic? The answer is a resounding maybe. And here's what you should know about metformin when it comes to weight loss, as well as why your doctor actually may prescribe it for you. When doctors prescribe metformin for weight loss, even if a patient does not have diabetes or prediabetes, then it is called an off-label use. That means the FDA has not approved metformin as a weight loss aid. As a result, there is less information about how effective it is for that purpose. There are, however, some newer studies that do show metformin helps with weight loss, but the drug is not a quick fix solution or a magic pill. According to one long-term study, the weight loss from metformin tends to occur gradually over 1 to 2 years. The amount of weight loss also varies from person to person, as I'll explain why. In one of the studies, the average amount of weight loss after 2 or more years was between 4 to 7 pounds. Taking metformin without following other healthy habits may not lead to weight loss. Individuals who follow a healthy diet, that is, lowering their carbohydrate intake and exercising while taking metformin, tend to lose the most weight, and most importantly, they keep it off. Those who decide to follow the old school outdated weight reduction schemes where they keep their intake of carbohydrates high and then they severely restrict their calories at the same time in attempt to lose weight, always gain it back, plus more, in a vicious, non-ending circle where, in the end, they end up gaining more weight than when they began. In the Diabetes Prevention Program study, their aim was to examine the effectiveness of metformin as a weight-reducing drug in obese and overweight patients with regards to their degree of insulin resistance over a 2-year period. Patients with severe insulin resistance actually lost more weight as compared to the insulin-sensitive patients. The metformin patients did lose body weight compared to the placebo, but what was interesting, not all had waist circumference reductions, and the untreated control group actually gained weight over the life of the study. What was also enlightening was the weight loss remained for at least 10 years and was related to the adherence to metformin. One of the major benefits of metformin is that it not only caused weight loss, but it did not cause any weight gain. And this is not true for many of the medications used to treat diabetes. So why did the metformin work better in the resistant group of patients? And what big clue did the researchers miss? And why? Hint, it had to do with the waist circumference. We now know metformin increases sensitivity. Thus, it lowers the amounts of insulin required by the body. Lower insulin levels allow the body to start removing or oxidizing the fats inside the muscle tissue and in the liver to be then used for energy. Remember, it is where the fats are coming from that is the key. The reason waist circumference did not drop or drop by much in many of the resistance participants was because the metformin was removing the fats you cannot see, the dangerous toxic ones inside the body. Now, this is very important to understand the limitations of the medication. Metformin monotherapy only reduces our A1Cs by around 1.1%. That is why it's not a miracle drug by any means. If one is still consuming a traditional high carbohydrate food guide pyramid style of diet, then metformin's leveraging action cannot and will not work. It has to be used in conjunction to a lifestyle, exercise, and diet change concurrently. This is where metformin shines. When I was first diagnosed, I was incorrectly misdiagnosed and typed as a type 2 diabetic, but I was also given metformin therapy. At the time of diagnosis, I was also heavily emaciated. I had lost a lot of weight, but I was still trying to eat as best as I can, and I was still exercising. I, for the first time, saw an increase in exercise performance with just the metformin addition alone. It was convincing as to how well my muscles responded to metformin in isolation. But unfortunately, with no pancreatic functioning, I actually should have been properly tested and put on insulin instead, and immediately. The metformin was able to reload my sugars into the muscles, but it was nowhere near enough to lower my blood sugars below the 200s without insulin. And here's why I'm doing this video on metformin today. I mentioned in a previous video, I have a brand new endocrinologist who wanted me to come off metformin to see if I actually even needed it at all because of my intensive exercise program and my already low carbohydrate diet approach. Would they be enough to warrant metformin's use? I removed metformin for the last several months only to realize the power metformin had at keeping my blood sugars even better regulated. I required not only more insulin, the bolus for meals, and my basal for the 24-hour coverage, but I could see my body composition began to change for the worse. What was most disappointing for me was the inconsistent readings I would get. When on metformin, I could tell you where my blood sugars were going to be plus or minus 10 to 20 points, but not anymore. I am actually back on metformin and I will continue to take this medication. So not only does metformin keep my blood sugars stable and low, but I can do this with, most importantly, lower insulin requirements, which again changes my body composition and improves my health markers all at the same time. Here's a picture taken just last week. Your health is not only based on how low your blood sugars are, but just not, if not more importantly, the critical part most of the experts out there are missing to this day is the amounts of insulin needed to keep blood sugars low and controlled. The lower the amount of insulin needed, the less the body inflammation, the healthier you will be. There are two more very important tips I want to share with you. The first has to do with the quality of metformin. Over the years, I have probably had 4 or 5 different generic brands prescribed to me, some of which actually smelt like dead rotting fish. I can tell you right here, right now, not all generics are created equal. Some gave me terrible gastric distress, whereas others did not. There is now, in my opinion, a continuous need for random assessment of the quality of metformin brands by our regulatory bodies to ensure compliance. A simple Google search on the quality of metformin will show you the gray variances between generic brands, and unfortunately, the vast majority of generics do come from overseas. So I recommend under no circumstances should one be using the generics. Ask your doctor for the name brand glucophage extended release or the XR versions at all times. Yes, the brand name is a bit more expensive, but well worth it. You get what you pay for when it comes to metformin. Second is the dose. More is not better when it comes to metformin. Studies show doubling the dose from 1,000 to 2,000 milligrams per day only adds approximately 0.25 to 0.3% change in one's A1C. That's it. If one is being prescribed metformin for weight loss, then 500 to 1,000 milligrams per day is pretty much all that is needed, maximum. That includes me too. There is no need for 2 to 3,000 milligrams per day. If one is using high amounts, then that tells you the diet is not optimized. Results will then be minimal and side effects will be exaggerated. Remember, metformin works best in conjunction to a low carbohydrate diet and exercise together. This is where you will see the changes to your health and your body, not even your eyes will believe. For those diabetics brand new to this channel, I'll create an important playlist for you with videos related to health as diabetics. In the video, how long can you live with diabetes? I'll cover the life expectancy of a type 1, a type 2, or even a type 1.5 LADA diabetic such as myself. The latest research is showing you can outlive your non-diabetic peers provided you are aware of the main factors that influence your health. And what are they? Which we will discuss in detail. One, how fast and accurately have you been diagnosed? Two, your doctor's overall view on the A1C and their ability to tailor your treatment to your specific diagnosis. And third, and most importantly, how promptly you execute on the correct diet plan. And what is a correct diet plan? There'll be multiple videos on exercise. In the video, why does exercise raise blood sugars? To understand this paradox, you first have to ask yourself what causes diabetes in the first place. In the case of a type 2 diabetic, there may be a combination of causes. What has just been discovered is the revolutionary reasoning behind the mechanisms of the disease. New technology has revealed those important links, and once known, will change your approach towards remission. We know as diabetics, there is no cure. But what has just come to light will enable you to control and master this disease in ways you never could have imagined. If you're on your desktop or laptop, use that mouse to click that upcoming box. If you're on a mobile device, tap that with your fingers. The first is the link to subscribe to this all-important channel. The second is the link to the playlist mentioned earlier. So, have a great and productive day, and we will see you soon with another new episode, which I said are always released weekly. Bye for now.